the Nomiki Show.
We've been incredibly frustrated with the fight against fascism. I don't know what could be more clear than the attacks on the Capitol, attacks on democracy, than folks storming the Capitol. But this is where we are. The FBI has said that it is not coordinated, as spoken by Reuters in a report. But that's not going to stop us from fighting fascism. So we have to bring forward every single tactic to fight fascism. And of course, this is something we discuss on the show all the time. Feminism is a key aspect of that. Ava, I'm going to see if I get your name right. Majewska, is that correct?
Perfect.
Is the author of, perfect, thank you, is the author of Feminist Antifascism, Counter Republics of the Common. She is a feminist philosopher and a former affiliated fellow at the Institute of Cultural Inquiry. Ava, thank you so much for joining us and for writing about this. I'm going to mute my line because these crazy cicadas that come out every 17 years or so are in my ear so right now. But our audience knows I'm on the road. So let's just start off with what inspired you to write this book at this moment, given your work in this space for so long? Why did we need to talk? Why was it that this needed to be said that a great, probably the best tool to fight fascism is through the feminist movement?
I thank you so much. First of all, thank you so much for having me in your show. And I'm really happy to contribute to spread the not only the anti-fascist good news, let's say, but also this idea, which some years ago still seemed a little bit abstract, and now it's becoming concrete, that feminism is perhaps at the core, at the center of today's anti-fascism. This is actually the fantastic discovery that I've made some time ago during a conference about fascism and the roots of fascism, the research of fascism that was conducted at the Polish Academy of Science 2 years ago in 2019, when we hosted several fantastic scholars from Britain, from Poland, from Germany, who were speaking about fascism and opposition to it in this very, I would say, male-centered way. So they were fantastic and very polite people who were extremely open to the idea that women exist and that we also, you know, contribute to politics and to culture. Yet they were using the very traditionalist paradigm in which political philosophy is, let's say, here, and then feminism is located somewhere on the margin. So basically, they agreed to the fact that feminism exists and feminist politics exists and feminist theory exists. However, they were sort of conveniently locating it at the margin of the spectrum of the political theory. So therefore, there was anti-fascism, which was somehow not feminist, not anti-feminist though, but not feminist, and then feminism somewhere on the outskirts. So the operation I'm trying to do is actually to say, okay, today, especially in the political movements, in the mobilizations against ultra-conservatism globally, basically, because we speak about the United States of America, we speak about Brazil, about Poland, about other countries, Spain, the Mediterranean, where you are actually, so also Greece and Italy, and other places where feminists opposed to the return of the ultra-conservative ideology. But also the movement Black Lives Matter, it has been described and orchestrated by women, basically, right? So at this point, it was actually possible to say that the feminist agenda is actually at the core of anti-fascism. So we cannot anymore locate it on the outskirts, on the margins. We have to see it as the core. And so when we look at today's fascism, when we look at fascist tendencies, let's put it this way, so when we look at the politics, anti-misogynist politics of Donald Trump, for instance, those aspects where he really treated women as objects and tried to find ultra-conservative way of, you know, marginalizing women, of reducing our reproductive rights and political position. When we look at Bolsonaro, when we look at Kaczyński and our Polish government, who recently restricted tremendously the right to abortion, we see that today's fascism actually locates body politics, reproductive rights at the core. So therefore, the answer to today's fascism has to acknowledge this shift in well, it's not a shift in perspective, because if we look at Nazi Germany, obviously they also knew where the woman's place is. However, today, I think the resistance to gender theory, gender studies, you know, all this anti-gender movements. So I was also inspired by scholars who are researching today's far right, obviously, when I was reading their work, Elżbieta Korolczuk, for instance, Agnieszka Graf, they published also in the American journals. They speak about today's fascists or today's right wing as anti-women, anti-LGBTQ, anti-reproductive rights. So I was like, okay, so probably next step in this theorizing is that today's anti-fascism has to be feminist. Otherwise, it will just miss the point. So although racism, anti-refugee politics, et cetera, are obviously still also at the core of the fascist politics, somehow, the politics of the body, the politics of the of gender is actually also central. So this is maybe
no. This is fascinating because I'm curious, in the U.S. in the progressive movement, in some spaces in the progressive movement, there is a debate between whether or not we should lean on identity politics or not, and I personally find myself frustrated with this often, because I think it's overly simple to just say, you know, identity politics, quote unquote, identity politics is used as a weapon sometimes by capital, those in power to basically marginalize arguments and push them out of the equation. But simultaneously, there's an intersectional approach to this. And I think, you know, when you say that feminism needs to be part of the anti-fascism strategy, or women, arguably, and supporting women and putting it forward, whether it's reproductive rights or other rights, putting women's voices forward. That's the strategy for anti-fascism. But is misogyny almost universally a strategy for fascism, alternatively? Because I feel as if this is not discussed enough and made clearly enough that, you know, whether it's Bannon's toolbook or the Five Star Movements, to whoever it is, it always seems to be a centerpiece. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, I couldn't agree more. And I would say, in my book, one of the last chapters discusses weak resistance. And this idea for weak resistance is basically that in order to to revolutionize the political, the thinking about political agents, but I can also say in order to revise the idea of political agency, we have to look at it from the perspective of those who have been conveniently put on the margin or discriminated against, etc. So if we look at the traditional model in the political philosophy, a traditional model of political agency, it's always highly heroic, super masculine. It's shaped to the it's shaped for the masculine socialization. It's shaped for men, basically. So if you are a woman, you have to adjust. You have to either be as strong, as brave, as heroic as all the, you know, historical men were, or otherwise you have to gain this heroic and strong position. So, and this is also a tendency in fascism. You know, if you look at the ideology of Karl Schmitt, of Nazi Germans, you see there this Übermensch, they even say it. They want to produce the turbo man. And actually, in English, it's a convenient language, because man is the same word for man and for like humanity. So basically, what they want is a Übermensch, Uber person, Uber people. So if we want to really revolutionize, I will use this word. If we want to revolutionize the political theory, if we want to make it feminist as it should be, we need to look at the structure of how we understand political agency. And we simply cannot any longer understand it only via those criteria of heroism, of sacrifice, of strength, of force, of explicit expression. We have to look at those who have been resisting. And here I was very much inspired by a Czech theater writer, but also a president of Czech Republic, Václav Havel. So I tried also to look at theories from my region of the world, and I found Havel, who was amazingly interesting in his essay, The Power of the Powerless. where he spoke of this mundane, perhaps everyday resistance that you can perform even if you are desperately searching for a means of expression, and even if you know that the empire is much stronger than you are, and whatever you can imagine is probably futile, and yet still you can perform, you can persist in this resisting position. So I was thinking of all those people who were survivors of traumatic moments. They are also not perhaps, I'm not trying to say that they were not heroic or that they were not brave, but bravery or heroism is not the first aspect you see. You might be looking at a very weak, a very tormented person, and yet they survived, they resisted, they didn't give up. They basically were politically active in ways that for some reason, I mean, for patriarchal reasons, were not thematized as proper political agency. So what I'm trying to say is basically that to be political does not necessarily have to mean to be brave, explicit, articulate even. James Scott depicts the peasants in South East Asia who sometimes are protesting only by marching, whose postulates and demands are sometimes even not explicitly mentioned. Those people are just continuing on protest in silence sometimes or with some banners, but not in those ways that we tend to imagine as political agency. And yet, there we are. So basically, rethinking the strategies of oppression and producing an intersectional feminist criticism of it is one part of what I'm trying to do. But another part is basically to look at resistance as not only performed by means of fight, by means of articulate expression, sometimes dissimulation, you know, this kind of resistance that Judith Butler is depicting in Gender Trouble, in the practices of drag. This is a very nice example of I would, something that I would call weak resistance. It's not, you know, it's not a powerful, you know, strength-based performance of politics. It's basically a politics which dismantles the gender binary codes, which puts a question mark over how we imagine femininity, masculinity, and other forms of being a human, a gendered human being. I hope it answers.
No, of course. This is very, very, very thought-provoking. So obviously sexism is not universally just held by the fascists. we struggle within the movement as well. And I think sometimes it can be difficult to explain how forms of sexism exist on the left while simultaneously trying to build solidarity around supporting women and making feminism a centerpiece to the anti-fascist movement. What would you advise for folks who, you know, maybe there are men in the movement who, or women, who see themselves as feminists, but may not necessarily fully understand all aspects of what it means to be a feminist and how that's crucial to the anti-fascist movement. And I say that in a sense of, okay, so maybe being in solidarity, like if a member, keeping it very simple, if a member of a squad is being attacked by somebody on the internet who has sympathies towards fascists or is just angry or whatever, how do we ask our allies to support women who are being courageous so that there is this more collective, universally collective solidarity, you know, in backing them up? Because the truth is if you do have the courage to step forward as a woman, you're likely to get attacked more.
Absolutely. I think there are all kinds of and very, very many ways. So basically what I'm going to say is probably quite particularly built in my own, I don't know, scholarship and activist experience. But one of my greatest teachers, although I never met her in person, was bell hooks. And I actually translated feminist theory from margin to center into Polish. And I was one of the first people to teach about feminisms of color. So I work also quite a bit with Chicana feminism. So with Gloria Anzaldúa, Cheri Moraga, and other writers who whom I find extremely inspiring. And it was actually the Professor Paola Bacchetta from University of Berkeley in University of California in Berkeley, who introduced me to those to Anzaldu and Moraga, especially. And I'm super. And she's also practicing transnational feminism and anti-fascism since many, many years. So she's also somebody whom I value tremendously. So basically there are all kinds of ways, but let's come back to bell hooks for a second. So bell hooks advises that men are also responsible for feminism. They should not only be allowed a place within feminist struggle, but as sexism and patriarchy makes men far less happy and fulfilled creatures, it's actually advisable for men to revision, to revise, sorry, and to revolutionize perhaps their ways of being. So for instance, exclusive, privileged behaviors, all kinds of silencing of those who seem weaker than who we are practices that have to be revised. And this is extremely difficult. In my essay in Iflux, which can be found online, I depict a situation where I play a board game with four colleagues of mine who are men. And for 45 minutes, they speak among themselves. It's incredible. You know, we play, the four of us, and I start feeling like a five-year-old younger sister of those boys who is absolutely not given any voice. So I do what I usually do in this kind of situations when men are, you know, talking to each other and I'm out. I basically speed up and start to win. That's something that some people have basically is like certain intellectual capacity and the audacity to use it. Okay, you don't listen to me. I'm going to write one book, two books, five books. Perhaps, you know, after the 10th book, I'm going to be heard. So basically some people, probably it's connected with some mild, autistic spectrum. Some people go to the skills they have, whatever they are, artistic, you know, intellectual, whatever. They try to, or connection building. So being a friendly organizer, friendly manager even, or I don't know, in all kinds of professions you can have this. So that's one of the strategies, is kind of to try to gain your voice, basically. So for instance, within the discussions about the artistic or intellectual canon, I'm very much forward to attribute authorship to women, to people who are queer. There are now fascinating discussions in the art sector about how do we make inclusive collections, not only in the sense of having enough women in the collections, which used to be a concern, but also, you know, what about non-binary people? What about, you know, do we want to have a representation of lesbian art? And then how many percent, let's say, of the art collection? So basically, you know, so on one hand, there is an effort to gain some voice, to actually establish yourself as an author, but not in authoritarian way. So this becomes tricky already, because obviously the typical anti-authoritarian strategy not to be authoritarian is to resign from authorship. But then the authorship goes back to where it used to be always, to white privileged men. So I'm not sure if we can afford this kind of, generosity. I think that as underprivileged people, many of us might want to exercise authorship, perhaps in a deterrent, you know, perhaps in a shifted way. Perhaps we can share authorship. Perhaps, for instance, when we speak on this show, it's your show, I'm the guest, so basically it's a collective effort, right? It's like difficult to, so that's a way of avoiding this kind of stardom that used to be so individualistic. So I'm speaking about it also in my book about counterpublics of common, understood as also an effort to dismantle this individualism, which is at the core not only of liberal politics, not only of conservative politics, but also, unfortunately, of many progressive, social democrat and otherwise progressive politics, where there is the me, and I'm the so basically I'm always a little bit, you know, it's a problem for me to put my name on a book because there is so many. So this is why the thank you part, you know, the credits list is so long, because I feel that there were students of mine who wrote the book in a way with me, in a sense that when we were working in seminars and lectures, obviously they were contributing to my anti-fascism, also teaching me what anti-fascism is today. They are 20 years younger than myself. So basically we had fantastic conversations about how anti-fascist theory and anti-fascist practice has changed, and how, for instance, the notion of privilege is central today. It wasn't like this 20 years ago, when I was, you know, beginning to put my first steps in activism and anti-fascist theory, privilege was not at the center in the debates, at least in Poland or in this part of Europe. It was rather masculinity. We were trying to silence men, for instance, to say like, okay, you go silent. Basically, for the whole meeting, you sit silently and listen. We were actually performing this kind of experiments. So we're saying, okay, one meeting is going to be conducted by women only. You're going to sit there and maybe sometimes take the voice. But if you can sit silent for 2 hours, it will be fantastic, because it's going to show us how, you know, how even, you know, on the audio level, it's different voices. I have quite a low voice for a woman, but still it's much higher than the majority of male voices. And men tend to only hear those low, also this same audio kind of discrimination goes for accents. It's fantastic and scary to what extent in Poland, for instance, Ukrainian people often speak very well Polish, but they have very heavy Eastern accent, as we say. It's a little bit like, I don't know, people from South America in America who speak fluent English, yet they have heavy accent. And then racism begins already on this level of how, you know, somebody hears the accent and they go like, oh, you're not a full citizen. You're probably something worse. And this is a typical racist thinking, although the color of the skin is not visibly different, right? But racism begins somehow on this level of the audio. So basically doing all kinds of experiments and performing all kinds of unusual situations of reversal of power used to be a strategy that we were doing in all kinds of ways, also in the classroom. Polish language is gendered. So we can address somebody as a woman or as a man. We are trying to experiment with the them. Although in Polish we have a neutral version also, but it's very much kind of objectifying. It's very much for objects. So not everybody who is non-binary wants to use this pronoun. So the son of my friend, for instance, Adash, the fantastic Adash, who wants to be non-binary, they are now 11 years old. In English, they function as they, so it's easy. But in Polish, you know, they don't want to be this neutral pronoun, so they change the grammar, the declination, the conjugation of verbs, and they invented their own grammar. So I'm trying to learn it. It's very difficult. It's very new. But, you know, so for instance, trying to make new communication forms, new organization forms, this is not very difficult. It takes 5 minutes to adjust to a new scenario. So these are kind of small steps that if we do every day, we are more careful, I think, on a daily basis about those distinctions and differences. And we know from sociology, from Pierre Bourdieu, from Althusser, from Judith Butler as well, from Rancière, how those little markers of class, they were, you know, the French theory works on it in class context, but Fanon works on it in anti-colonial context. So basically there are all kinds of spectrum. So if we practice on a daily basis this kind of little differentiation, and also if we try to use difference in order to learn more egalitarian world, that's already good. But I think that we also need to think, and this is why I speak of counterpublics of the common, and this is why I try to sort of kidnap the notion of public sphere and take it away from the hands of liberal or conservatives, because I don't want it to be only in their hands. I also want to be capable to discuss the public sphere. And this is what outraged my anti-fascist colleagues in Poland, because they told me public sphere is such a reactionary concept. I was like, but it doesn't have to be. It can be. We can very well make it not only inclusive, because I don't want to, like, I don't feel entitled to include anyone. So I'm very careful with using this inclusivity notion. But yet I know many people who have fantastic intentions and who are practicing it well. I cannot use it, basically. So I don't want to include anybody. I think we are diversified already, and we need to, in our everyday thinking, in our everyday practice, we need to understand that the world is already diversified, that there are groups of people, entire groups of people, who remain invisible for us, even if we are leftists, feminists, queer people, whomever else. We might not notice that our neighbor belongs to some sort of group that we didn't even think of existed. Like, for instance, people with disabilities, we learn right now, or psychological shouldn't use the word disorder already, right? But it's like
there's people have there's multiple identities attached to people, and what right. Somebody puts forward as first versus second, and it depends on the circumstances, you know. simple example, I'm in Greece right now. I am a Greek American, but when I'm in the US, I identify more as, you know, as every aspect of you comes out in different ways at different moments based on your community and what you want to put forward. I want to touch base just real quick because the public sphere is really interesting to me. You know, we're not in a democratized world where the public sphere is accessible to everybody and everybody's voices are given the same strength. I mean, we started off the show talking about how, at least off record, how this show on Fridays is here because it is the political YouTube site is a very male dominated space and the algorithm has been outed as being sexist and racist. I personally fear that the silencing of other voices, whether intentional or not, or dealt with or not, or acknowledged or not, these things shouldn't be debatable, but they are debated right now, maybe intentionally so that they're not actually dealt with. But it's a form of silencing is a form of fascism. So, you know, get back to the first part is fascism has a toolkit, and silencing opponents and silencing dissent is a big part of that. And if feminism is a central part of challenging fascism and fighting fascism, you know, when the space, the public forum is not egalitarian, how do we fight, especially in a monopoly world that we live in today? You know, how do we take that on? I mean, are there strategies we're not seeing today for the modern world that didn't exist 50 years ago or 100 years ago that we're just not seeing?
So for the debate about public sphere, I'm looking at the at some Polish events that happened in 1980, so around the year when I was born. So a time that is distant not only geographically for US American people, but also, you know, chronologically. But many of us probably heard the name Solidarność or Solidarity still, and it was a movement that was created by means of resistance. So, and it was a solidarity strike that started after a woman worker of the shipyard, a woman who was not working in an office, who was a crane operator, was fired 3 months before going to retire. So it was a terrible, you know, terrible situation. And this woman, as she was a motherly figure for a lot of people in the shipyard in Gdańsk in Poland, obviously her firing caused a lot of turmoil. So a solidarity strike started, and then different workplaces started to join. So basically, you know, this is a kind of, and imagine or not, believe it or not, after 6 months, this movement was registered as a labor union, and it contained 10 million people. It wasn't a milliard of years ago. It was 40 years ago. It was still possible. As somebody who tried to introduce a syndicalist union at the University of Warsaw, and you know, when I started to work with other people on the making of this union, we realized that it might be difficult to gather 10 people to open this union. 10 people, not 10 million, not 10,000. 10. It was the University of Warsaw. It's 5,500 workers, employees. So it's not that it's a tiny little university which doesn't have, you know, employees. It's a big university, but everybody is so afraid of joining a proper union that they prefer not to, basically. So I'm looking at examples from the local experience and local area. Also, not to exoticize, you know, the experiences of, let's say, Black Afro-American, you know, activists, which, by the way, I mean, when I translated bell hooks, it was actually very useful. It was actually a discourse that opened the eyes of certain feminists to the problematic of class. So it's amazing how you have to get an author from another hemisphere, basically, to comprehend something which you deal with on a daily basis and which has been theorized, obviously, by Polish authors, by European authors, and by the, you know, state communism that we've had not so long ago as a running system. So coming back to the previous topic of the practice of anti-sexism, for instance, sometimes it's necessary to actually kind of go a little bit further or invite somebody from very far away, you know, and to see our own experience in a perspective that this person is setting. And for me, it was the feminists of color. So feminists, Black, like Afro-American feminism, the Chicana feminist. But this also matters for the public sphere, because Poland is a country which, for the majority of our citizens, we think we are white and more or less, you know, similar in our situation, which is obviously untrue. And we have growing discrepancies in income, in position. We have now a population of 500,000 of Ukrainian citizens living in Poland and work and doing a lot of work for us and being treated like semi-humans, basically. You know, so our daily racism is not necessarily based on color, although unfortunately right now, for instance, we have Afghan refugees held on the border between Poland and Belarus by the Polish guards, border guards. There are 50 people, defenseless, basically. They didn't bring, you know, arms, or they basically are asylum seekers. And they are being held for a week now on the Polish-Belarusian border by the racist government. I must call my government this way, because this is racism. This is purely racist incentive. And luckily, some Social Democrat parliament members also went there. So they sort of make sure that, you know, the case is televised and nothing bad happens to those people. But on the other hand, why are they supposed to sit on this border, in this no man's land between the borders? So basically, coming back to your question about public sphere, we need to think of bigger scale as well. We need to look at our micropolitics, at our daily basis experience, because this is necessary. If we are racist or sexist to our, you know, partners, children, neighbors, students, everybody, it's just not going to help to build a different society and to understand, you know, bias and privilege, etc. But we need also to think about the scale. And I think for many years, the radical left was very preoccupied with micropolitics and was very preoccupied with not looking at the bigger scale. With going like, okay, we're going to make our little squad, our little this, our little that, and we're going to sit there peacefully. But in the meantime, of course, historically, you know, it was perhaps necessary to revisit those micro spheres. But, you know, the way we build, we are gendered, is made not only in micro scale. It is made on the big level of state-run schools, of churches, who in Poland, Catholic Church is a fantastic machine producing inequality on a daily basis. You know, we have it's like a monarchy coexisting with a democratic society. On this level already, it's a paradox. I'm not speaking about God, because I'm agnostic. I don't have good proofs that God doesn't exist, so I will not quarrel with anyone about it. I don't believe in it, but, you know, I'm not going to contradict. I'm quite open-minded in this way. But the authoritarian structure of the church in Poland is scary, and it should evolve, because otherwise it's just going to bring a bad example to the society, which should be learned about equality. In our constitution, we have equality, and yet a priest is a better human being than a normal person. Come on. That's, you know, that has to be negotiated. And we need to have audacity to claim this kind of revisions. So basically, this is where the public begins. The public, as there is a fantastic author who inspires me a lot, Rosalind Deutsch. She's American scholar working in the field of art history and art theory, and she speaks of critical art, of public art, not as one that is, you know, residing outdoors. This is a very common definition of public art. It's like something that is outdoors. No, we don't need something to be outdoors. We need public sphere, or public art for that matter, to renegotiate the relation between what is public and what is private. This is what public art or public sphere is about. So public sphere is not only, you know, a debate that happens outside of our home, because as pandemic has shown, we are sitting at homes and conducting public debates very well. So it becomes public when we question certain composition of the society, when we question certain composition of decision making, when we question the existing composition of what is perceived as important or common or ruly or visible. So when we have the audacity, of claiming like, okay, I don't like the way this government is organized. I don't want the men to have more of a say than women. That requires a certain audacity. However, it is not only by explicit articulation that we make that kind of intervention. So this is one of the ways, is if we are powerful enough to have, for instance, a show on YouTube, which has some audience, which is already a sort of privilege, because lots of people try it and they don't get to address a larger audience, right? So So other ways are, for instance, protest, solidarity protest, you know, resistance to fulfill the duties. There were fantastic protests of Amazon workers in the time of pandemic. Those workers were overworked and endangered to get COVID because Bezos wanted to collect money for his whatever he whatever he wanted, right?
So,
spaceship. I was thinking of a white big dick because for some reason I've seen some comments online that were comparing the spaceships to you know a part of a male body, but. Anyway, those workers, they were not, you know, making shows online or appearing in television. But what they did was basically to refuse to pack another thing that we ordered online, right? They refused to fulfill their duties. And by that, they made a point about how their safety is not taken care of. And how the workload and working hours are too long. So basically, there was old fashioned because many people on the radical left already think that we are so, you know, so immaterialized and so detached from factory production modes that we have nothing to do with the 19th century forms of strike. By the way, interestingly, the first strikes were apparently made in the US. In North America by Polish immigrants in 16th or 17th century. I can't remember, but the first protest that was called a strike, so the first work-connected kind of resistance, was actually Polish people. So it seems to run in the in the region, and I'm kind of proud of it because this is a means of renegotiating what is common and what is public in the region where I live. So basically, this is what I try to, you know, bring into the global discussion. It's like, okay, we have this example. Here we have the example of resisting certain forms of labor and via that resistance, renegotiating. So for instance, the women's protests in Poland were called women's strike, right? So what became the international women's strike was actually started in Poland. And was referencing the strikes that I mentioned, the Solidarity strike with Anna Walentynowicz, so the beginnings of Solidarity movement. Our strike of today was referencing, our feminist women's strike was referencing the strikes from 40 years ago. So they are interconnected, you know, they are not. So my thinking of public sphere is one which does not... which is not detached from workplaces and the sector of work. This is, I think, important. In most classical narratives about the public sphere, labor is sort of privatized. It's basically our private business, where we work, how much we earn. These are not topics. So I'm bringing in not only Karl Marx, who obviously wanted to make the income also a part of a public debate. So a very interesting, you know, example of public thinker. But I'm bringing in the film producer and theorist Alexander Kluge, who wrote about counterpublics of the proletarians. So who tried to explain how within the workplaces public issues are debated in a different way than the ones the public sphere organized within the bourgeoisie, within the upper classes. So he made this point that actually non-bourgeois citizens, not middle class citizens, are also producing public debate, but one which is built on different presumptions. So for instance, where the involvement in fulfilling basic needs is not excluded of what is public. That's the main difference. So these are already, you know, more details of the theory I'm talking about, but it's important, it has implications for how we understand anti-fascism. Because in many anti-fascist politics, we are discussing about what, you know, about racism understood as a certain idea about the other. It's not about ideas. You know, when the Polish people are racist towards Ukrainians, it's not about our ideas. Most people don't think too much about Ukraine. It's basically about paying less because somebody does not have a Polish passport. So it's basically connected. So it's in the field of labor where this racism is. And I think it goes the same in the US, right?
It's channeling the frustration of the, going back to individualism, of the individual, which Trump did so well, which is not a new tool, you know, and targeting it towards the other. I mean, you see it at all different levels. It's fascinating. And I keep going back to the tech space because you see multiple different allies of the fascist movement and actual, what I would diagnose as fascists, you know, echoing each other and using similar tactics against different people. So on one hand, you might have the Trumpian folks who are targeting Mexicans for taking their jobs. On the other hand, you might have the Jimmy Dore left, which I'm not expecting you to know who they are, targeting, you know, women for specifically not saying that, you know, it's women's fault, but they're only targeting women who tend to speak up about anything related to equality, and simultaneously people of color. So it's really interesting how these tactics are all very similar about the other, and it's all about tapping in one group's economic anxiety, especially in the US, economic anxiety, status anxiety, and tapping into whatever it is their access point. And so, you know, sexism does exist on the left, and there's economic anxiety in the left. And so how do you peel off those folks and bring them into this other space? So it's super interesting. Ava, I could talk about this for hours. I could listen to you for hours. I would love to have you back on. I would love to continue this conversation if you're open to it. And I'll be back, you know, in the studio, not in Greece, but I would really love to do so if you're open.
Very much. Thank you so much. And for me, it was also a pleasure to talk about it. And when you are in Greece, I hope, you know, all those fires are going to stop soon, and I hope you're safe and happy there. Mm-hmm.
So far, so good. I'm in Crete now, but I definitely got away from the area of the fires earlier this week. So it's a whole other conversation. I mean, okay, next time we're on, I want to talk about Poland, because I remember just, I don't know, a half a year ago being like, I can't believe Poland's blocking all refugees, to now it's happening in social democratic led countries and center right countries like Greece, where everybody's now blocking refugees. So, you know, I think that's a very good indication of how things shift based on the far right.
Absolutely. I believe also that Poland, you know, since neoliberal times has been a place where certain things were introduced and then practiced elsewhere. Obviously, you know, Argentina also got their, and Chile got their share of neoliberal politics, but Poland was in Europe one of the first countries to have this harsh neoliberal capitalism introduced as, you know, as a shock doctrine, basically. I very much agree with Naomi Klein with the diagnostics over there, because her chapters about Poland are fantastic. As somebody living here, I must only confirm that, unfortunately, her diagnosis is really good. So I think, and it was fantastic for us to see how this women's protests have spread throughout, you know, throughout the world, and how our communication of how we need to resist the, you know, the sexist politics by means of ordinary, you know, people, by means of strike, by means of, we had also this moment of using social media, which might be interesting for you. So one of the first stages of the women's protest in 2016 was an invitation for women to post on social media their black and white picture saying, I support black protest, black for the clothes we were wearing. So basically the color black was important to signalize the participation in women's strike. So some 250,000 women, you know, posted the support message on social media. And for many of them, so my hypothesis immediately was that for many of them, it's going to be easier to walk on the streets, to take part in street protests after posting on social media. And it proved to be true. So many women later were investigated by my friends, sociologists, you know, who made broad interviews with them, and they were confirming that it was actually a kind of mid step. So in Poland, for instance, the social media impact on the protest was positive in a sense that for many people who were not politically active, the social media step was the first step to, you know, to bigger activism. So it was not only, you know, those who were political activists who orchestrated those strikes, but it was kind of ordinary people as well, as controversial as the category might sound.
I mean, it's unfortunate. It's the worse it gets, but the more people awaken. I mean, we saw it as well as with the election of Trump. How many people? But it's what you do with it, right? That's a whole other conversation. What do you do? For us, it was the Women's March. where does that go afterwards? What seeds are planted and how do those seeds grow? Maybe it's elections, maybe it's, other organizations, but, you know, tough times. Ava, thank you very much for joining us today. Really appreciate it. Stay safe. And hopefully we'll have you back on soon.
Thank you so very much. Enjoy. And send me the link. And thank you so much. It was very generous. Thank you. Bye-bye.